This week on Cracked Science, epigenetics is cool, and some people even think it will turn you into Jesus. Hey, this is Jonathan Jerry, and you're watching Cracked Science, the show from the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. Our topic today is epigenetics. Epigenetics is like Daniel Baldwin. You know Alec really well, you're familiar with Billy and Steven, but Daniel is the one you vaguely heard of but have no idea what he does. For your information, he was in Stripperland, a movie about a virus that turns women into carnivorous zombie strippers. Daniel is also featured on the soundtrack, rapping, "The More You Know." Epigenetics is a word you'll hear more and more in the media. And content warning, this story ends with Deepak Chopra. To define epigenetics, let's focus on baking. You may remember my analogy from episode 14. Genes make proteins, but genes aren't always making proteins. It's like a bread maker making bread. They make baguettes and ciabatta during the day, but they sleep at night. Before a big holiday, they may get an increase in customers, and they have to work longer and make more bread. It's the same situation with a gene. How much protein it makes depends on a number of factors. These factors, collectively, are known as the epigenome, and the field that studies it is called epigenetics. And how the epigenome influences how much bread is being made can be explained rather simply. You see, DNA needs to be physically accessible so that proteins can be made from it, just like a baker's hands need to be free for her to make bread. Keep an eye on the DNA helix and what happens to it when a cascade of events is put into motion by a simple epigenetic mark. The DNA close to that mark turns into a ball. It gets compressed and it can't be accessed anymore. That stretch of DNA is now silent. Not yet, Deepak. We're not done with the science. When you hear me say consciousness, you can come out. Perhaps the most interesting thing about our epigenome is that it changes. Our DNA sequence, the A's and T's, all that, that doesn't change very much in our lifetime, except for the odd mutation, but our epigenome is plastic. It responds to our environment. As far as we know, pretty much anything can change our epigenome. The lifestyle of our mom when we're in the womb, UV radiation, exposure to various environmental chemicals like lead and arsenic, consumption of alcohol, stress, and diet, especially whether or not our mom's diet had enough folate in it when they were pregnant. These exposures can alter our epigenome even when we're in the womb. Now, you already know that we inherit genes from our mom and dad, but do we also inherit from our parents the epigenetic marks that can silence these genes? That is the controversial claim known as transgenerational epigenetic inheritance, meaning the transmission across many generations of these epigenetic factors. Some scientists are saying they have evidence that pregnant women who go through periods of mass hunger or traumas like surviving the Holocaust, that this affects not just the baby's epigenome, which would make sense, but the grandchildren as well, all the way down the family line. And this runs counter to what we know about epigenetics. Traditionally, we recognize that these marks are erased twice, first when the sperm and eggs are made, and again in the early stages of the embryo, like someone punching a big old reset button twice in a row. So what do we make of a paper like this that seems to offer proof that the reset doesn't happen? Well, here's what this particular paper actually shows, and warning, you may need to be an intellectual downhill skier to follow this double black diamond ski slope. It claims that grandma, before she was an adult, lived through a sharp change in food supply, and that this effect was passed down first to her sons, not her daughters, and then from those sons to their own daughters, but not their sons, and this led to an increase in death from heart disease. So again, this effect goes from grandma on your dad's side, through dad who is unaffected, and finally to you if you're a woman, but not if you're a man. This is not that different from my own study that shows that if your sister's grandpa's mistress was a smoker, your aunt-in-law's second great-cousin nephew might have a persistent cough at the age of 50. Kevin Mitchell, a professor of genetics and neuroscience at Trinity College Dublin, has a sobering assessment of this study. Not mine, but the double black diamond ski slope one. He writes that studies like this one, that seem to show evidence for the transmission of epigenetic marks across many generations, all suffer from similar problems. They are done with very few people. The scientists test so many things that something is bound to come up positive, And the scientists usually go in there wanting to find something, as opposed to wanting to test a specific hypothesis. This is known as researchers' degrees of freedom. And it's the equivalent of a poker player suddenly deciding that the five completely different cards she holds are actually called the hand of Genghis Khan, which can beat five royal flushes. You can't change the rules of the game, Belle. You can't. Transgenerational epigenetic inheritance may turn out to be the psychoanalysis of biology. It's a great way to blame relatives for all your problems, but it may not stand up to close scrutiny. Epigenetics, as a whole, is very real and fascinating. There are even cancer drugs like azacitidine that work at the level of the epigenome. But here's the lay of the land. In one corner, we have actual scientists producing flawed studies and debating amongst themselves which studies deserve to be taken seriously and influence our knowledge. These exchanges are healthy, and they represent science in action. In the other corner, we have this.
We now have evidence, and we've been doing this research at our center, that you can change the genomic activity in a way that extends your lifespan. So we feel, based on the research we've been doing, is that the human lifespan could be extended by 30 years. Only 5% of those typos or gene mutations that are associated with diseases are fully predictable, which means we don't know how to yet correct them. But 95% of them we control through our consciousness, which means...
And if this sounds familiar, it's because we have been through this with quantum mechanics and stem cells. Deepak Chopra and his posse are like kids the week before Christmas. Daddy, Daddy, can I open my gifts now? No? Mommy, Mommy, can I open my presents now? I want my epigenetics now! And that's a trend that we all have to learn to recognize. When a science is new, unqualified wellness gurus and swindlers alike will use early research results to give you lifestyle recommendations. And sure, eating more veggies is a good thing for your health, and reducing stress levels does have some impact on your epigenome, but you don't need to invoke the power of epigenetics for these recommendations to be valuable. Our knowledge of what influences our epigenome and how we can change the ways in which our genes are expressed is comparable to that map Christopher Columbus allegedly consulted. Sure, this vaguely looks like the old continent, but the details are really questionable, such as this notice that here is seen the orca, a sea monster that is like the sun when it shines, whose form can hardly be described, except that its skin is soft and its body huge. And this is where we are with epigenetics. Bold explorers are mapping it out, arguing with each other, developing better tools to gain precision and accuracy. Meanwhile, Deepak Chopra's friend Bruce Lipton decides to leave the map altogether and try to explain Jesus' miracles with epigenetics.
When Jesus actually said you could renew your life with your beliefs, this now, in an understanding of epigenetics, is actually profoundly true. This is exactly how it works. And it was interesting because he used to come off with the phrase something like you see me do all these miracles, but you can do them maybe even better than I can do them, but you don't believe in it, which again is the epigenetics.
My recommendation this week is a blog post from Dr. David Gorski, a surgical oncologist and skeptic, entitled Epigenetics, It Doesn't Mean What Quacks Think It Means. He provides more detail on the actual mechanisms of epigenetics, like DNA methylation, and surveys how people like Bruce Lipton and Joe Mercola misuse this area of research to sell you false self-empowerment. This blog post was published on Science-Based Medicine, of which Gorski is the managing editor, and the entire website is recommended for anyone who wants to know more about the issues and controversies in the health sciences, including regular commentary on quackery. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, do click that button and ring that bell to get notifications. Don't forget to subscribe to our weekly newsletter by going to mcgill.ca/OSS. In the meantime, you can follow me on Twitter @CrackedScience and join us next time for science that may or may not be all it's cracked up to be.